Okay. Namaste to all of you and a very warm welcome to this evening's Zoom call. As usual, you know the rules. What we do is my mic as well as Anurag Saxena's mic, both of them would be on and the rest of the mics would be muted so that we don't have noise pollution. And as is our routine practice, Anurag ji would give the initial talk, and after his talk is over, then we throw it open for Q&A. I'll just give a brief introduction of Anurag ji. He is based out of Singapore, but though his name sounds pretty much North Indian, he speaks pretty fluent Telugu. He's from Vizag and Hyderabad, so he's very fluent in Telugu as well. He leads a project called India Pride Project. So what does this project do? Since 1947 till about 2014, Indian government and Indian agencies could bring back only 13 of our artifacts which are stolen from our temples, murtis, vigrahalu, which are stolen and taken to foreign museums. Only 13 of them could be brought back. Whereas Anurag ji and his team in the India Pride Project, since 2013, they have brought back 236 artifacts already. So that's the work he's doing, right? It's a very prestigious project they are doing. Some of it very secretive. And of course, he needs a lot of connections and he's doing a fantastic job. In fact, his videos on YouTube are pretty famous. There are millions of views on that. That apart, he has been featured and published in BBC, Washington Post, Economic Times, Times of India, Sunday Garden, Guardian, Doordarshan, Man's World and whatnot, So he's a pretty active man. He's a chartered accountant, basically. He works in Singapore. But having said that, he's not going to talk about the India Pride Project. So India Pride Project is something he's pretty well known about. But today he's going to talk about Dharmicism. So this is a concept essentially, which is something rooted in Bharatiyata, which has got, it's an alternative view to capitalism and communism. Capitalism and communism have exploitative nature built right in their structure. Whereas Dharmicism is something which is rooted and based on Dharma. So it's a concept which is loosely available here and there, but he has put together a whole concept of it. I think he's also coming out with a book on it. So today we'll hear from him in terms of an alternate economic source when economic theory or economic policy, which is very much rooted in Indianness, once capitalism and communism fail. Communism has already failed and capitalism is more or less bound to fail. So let's hear from him. We leave the floor open to him. He prefers to talk in small bits, in small, packages. So let him first start the process. Once he is done to a part, then we'll probably push him further and then we'll take it from there. Once the initial thing is over, then we'll throw it open for question and answers. As always, kindly stick to the topic of the day and don't deviate in your questions. Also, please do not give long statements. Let's stick to the question precisely so that we can give audience to not many people. That's our humble request. Anurag ji, floor is yours.
Namaskar, everyone. Just quickly, other than whatever Giridhar ji has already added in terms of format for today, just a couple of requests from mine. Given that this is a lockdown situation and all of us are already stressed out, stuck at home with our wives, with our children, not getting a shave, not getting a haircut and things like that, I would like to keep today's conversation very informal, very friendly, very laid back. And to stick with that theme of mine, I have worn a simple ghar ka t-shirt. This is a conversation, not a talk. I have never proclaimed myself to be an intellectual, so clearly there is nothing I can teach anybody on this call. hopefully we will, I look at this as a process of manthan, where we collectively kind of share our thoughts on you know, India's economic ideology and the opportunity it presents, and hopefully take away something home. So the way I'm going to break it is, I will try and keep, you know, Giridharji was telling me about half an hour, 40 minutes of a talk. And I told him, ki, dekhi ji, I really have nothing to say for half an hour, 40 minutes, whatever. So I will keep it relatively shorter, about half that time. After that, I would like to follow it up with a Q&A discussion. But most importantly, in the end, I would like to leave you all with a small special project. But I'll come to that at the end. With that, Giridharji, if I have your permission, I will just start with the whole concept of dharmikism, or what is dharmikism?
Yes, sir. Floor is yours.
So the whole background or the idea of dharmikism was triggered in my head when a British friend once asked me a very simple question. He said, look, Anurag, I haven't seen any other society where wealth is worshipped, you know, where you have a concept of Lakshmi. How come India is socialist then? Now, if you think about it, this is a very serious and a deep question. No other country from their cultural or religious roots has the idea of Lakshmi or wealth actually built into their archetype or into their civilizational or cultural framework. India has always had that. So at which point did we decide to become socialist or communist? You know, so the way he said it is, ki, Anurag, where did you guys lose your way? And I thought that was a very important question, which got me started on this path. Now, we all know, if you look at, you know, so the world fundamentally, in terms of recent history, the last couple of centuries, had two primary concepts, capitalism and communism. Communism in its original format has already failed. Now, China might claim it is communist, but it really isn't. Capitalism, although is very successful, capitalism is premised on having one winner and 99 losers. That is the fundamental idea of capitalism. So if you look at the US, which is supposed to be the fountainhead of capitalism as we know it today, you know, the whole Occupy Wall Street movement was about the 99% people saying that, hey, listen, this doesn't work for us anymore. As nations rise and fall, you know, there's an opportunity to rethink models, not just on economics, but on multiple areas, and present those models. Right. Now, why is this the time to talk about the idea of dharmikism or India's own indigenous economic model? You see, we are seeing the downsides of every other economic, cultural, or social model, right? Brexit has shown that UK's political or economic dominance is not sustainable, right? The US-China trade war is only going to intensify after this COVID situation. The European Union, which when founded, was founded because it brought strength together. Now, member states of the EU are questioning, ki, are, is it really worth us being in here or not? You look at all the multilateral agencies. You know, just yesterday, or rather earlier today, our time in Asia, Donald Trump announced that their funding, the US funding to WHO, would be seized. A couple of years back, US and Israel walked out of UNESCO. You know, so we see a steady decline in the value and stature of multilateral agencies. The point I'm making is, a lot of institutions, structures, and ideas from the last century are now getting destroyed, which means there is space for new institutions. There is space for new ideas. There is space for new values to replace the vacuum that is being created. Right? Now, So the whole idea of dharmikism, as I propose it, is for India to ambitiously create a new economic model. And this is a very, very ambitious plan, right? for India to create and present a new economic model, which is an alternative to any model that exists currently, right? Now, why am I saying that it is an alternate economic model? How is it different from capitalism? How is it different from communism? So just a few thoughts on that. Giridharji and I are chartered accountants. For those of you who run businesses or who have worked for businesses, especially if you deal with Marwadis, Jains, Banyas, etc., you know that the idea of Shubh Labh, which is prosperity and profit, always have coexisted. Right? The whole idea that profit is not pariah, but it is the reason of human endeavor. The reason we are all putting an effort is to create something of value, is very intrinsic to our Indic ideology, right? You look at the whole idea of Riddhi Siddhi, which is expertise and success, always coexisted. Riddhi cannot exist without Siddhi, Siddhi cannot exist without Riddhi. We have learnings like these which are intrinsic, not just in our ancient texts, but they're part of our cultural DNA. People who do not know the roots of Shubh Labh and Riddhi Siddhi still follow it because they apply it in their day-to-day business, day-to-day living, right? Now, look at it historically. You know, in 1863, Charles Cook wrote very interestingly about India's thriving banking system. Now, this was in pre-colonial India, right? So he wrote about the strength of India's banking system and how it has been constantly attacked or eaten away for, you know, to enable Britishers to rule India monetarily, right? Dadabhai Moroji wrote Poverty of India a few years later, where he actually has documented how British institutions, many of whom were not as superior as existing Indian institutions, so how these British institutions were forcefully destroying institutions to create space for themselves. Now, this wasn't the first time that India was a victim to colonizers or mercenaries or whatever. We know the bloody history, the very bloodied, violent onslaught that we have had to face, right? You know, I give this example to a lot of people. Christopher Columbus set out originally to look for India, which is why it is West Indies and the Native Americans were called Indians and things like that. Now, the claim that is made, the history that is taught to Europeans was that Christopher Columbus was kind of on a, you know, he was going out to spread the word of God, right? And, you know, that Christianity should reach all four corners of the world, etc., etc. Now, very interestingly, and I'd like you all to Google it up if this interests you. In the letter that Christopher Columbus wrote seeking permission and funds to go out on this quest, he has mentioned the word Lord and God only once. However, he has mentioned the word gold 17 times. So think about it for a second. Forget whatever narrative Western historians have built today. Christopher Columbus, when he said, "I want to look for India," he said 17 times that, "Boss, I'm going to find gold over there." And that is the kind of economic might India used to have following our traditional principles that I call Dharmakism, right? Now, he was not successful, but the British and the Mughals were. For centuries, and there's no easier word to say it, but for centuries, they literally looted India. They filled their coffers, right? And it has continued for a very long time. The economic onslaught a little later, post-independence, got replaced later by an intellectual onslaught, right? You know, so you had Marxism develop. Marxism has never been about creating value. Marxism has always been about distributing value. Karl Marx never ever in his life talked about how value should be created, right? In fact, it was very interesting. Karl Marx's mother made a very interesting observation, a public statement about him. So Karl Marx's book was called Das Kapital. And she once said that, "I wish Karl, instead of just talking about capital, would earn it." Now, that is, if your mother finds holes or issues with your logic. You can imagine how flawed that logic was to begin with, right? But anyway, the intellectual onslaught started, and we know about the Macaulayization of history and the Marxism and this and that and whatever it is. But the interesting thing is, all these lenses have been Western lenses. They haven't been local Indic lenses. And some of it has resulted in what I believe are the biggest misinformation scams that unwittingly we have been subject to. Take the whole case of Hindu rate of growth. There is nothing like Hindu rate of growth, but that lie has been repeated to us so many times that we have internalized it and started believing it. Right? It's a self-deprecation to the nth degree. So what has happened is, to summarize, there is, and within a couple of sentences, I will stop up about the historical aspects. Right. So the fact that India was one of the world's largest economy is not disputed. The fact that Christopher Columbus or the Mughal invaders or the British wanted to get to India primarily for its wealth is also not disputed. The fact that post them giving away, we have forgotten this economic DNA. We have forgotten the pride that we should be taking. And we have started looking at ourselves using a Western lens is also clear now, right? My proposal of dharmicism is to say that let us get rid of all these shackles. Let us get rid of this Western lens. And let us see if there are any learnings from our own past that we can reapply to ourselves today and reemerge as an economic superpower that we used to be before we were invaded. Now, let's look at a couple of, so it's very interesting. Every time I talk to somebody who's in the Silicon Valley, or, you have people who run startups, you have venture capitalists, you have people that provide seed capital, et cetera, et cetera. There are some very interesting things you notice about this set of people. These are the hip and cool population that you have around the world, especially in Silicon Valley. Right? Now, if you look deep within, I think at a superficial level, there are a lot of practices that many of them are adopting. The whole idea about mindfulness, whether it is turmeric latte, whether it is veganism, whether it is yoga. So all these things are, in a way, superficial adaptations of our ancient wisdom. But if you dig down a little deeper into how their minds are wired, how is a Silicon Valley entrepreneur fundamentally thinking differently from people around him? The whole journey of an entrepreneur is that of seeking, is that of pursuit, what we would call sadhana in our terms, right? The whole idea of Advaita is very, very deeply entrenched into, companies don't describe themselves as companies anymore. There is a difference in the way a Vanderbilt or a Rockefeller built their fortune and how current billionaires are building their fortune. Everybody considers themselves a part of an ecosystem with components or players that are interdependent on each other, right? Look at how HR practices are being followed nowadays. All of this very deeply internalizes the whole idea. You see, the whole word ecosystem can be, the whole idea of interdependence or ecosystems can be rooted to the whole idea of Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Right. But more importantly, the idea, and this is where I would like you to think, I'm assuming all of you are in your 40s or 50s, I would like you to think of even 15, 20 years back of the typical Nehruvian Marxist economic concept we all grew up with. It was always about command and control, right? It was never about individual pursuit. Today's wealth creators are not about command and control at all. They are about freedom. They are about choices. They are about building interdependence and codependence to create wealth together. Right? You see, a lot of these startup guys keep talking about, you know, monetization and asset utilization and fancy terms like that. Right? Now, if you look at the whole idea of monetization, what is monetization? That I will take a product or a process which is worth X rupees and I will make 2X rupees out of it. That's the whole idea of monetization. Within the Western world, the whole idea of monetization itself is relatively new. You know, it was coined within our lifetimes. But look at what Chanakya said centuries back. He said, in the absence of fruitful economic activity, both current prosperity and future growth are in danger of destruction. I'll say that again. In the absence of fruitful economic activity, both current prosperity and future growth are in danger of destruction. Right? Now think about somebody ages back who is saying that the whole idea of prosperity is fundamentally an economic pursuit. The whole idea of future is dependent on being able to create wealth today, right? Similarly, you have the whole phrase asset utilization, right? You see banks and companies nowadays are talking about utilization rates, this, that, whatever it is. Again, Chanakya ages back said, the value of land is what man makes of it. Think about it. For somebody to have the insight to say that a land per se has no value. It is just a flat slab of mud lying somewhere. To understand that land had value and that value was what humans are made of it is a very, very deep insight, which is a relatively newer insight into the Western mindset. Right? And of course, he laid down very, very rules for taxation and things like that, and, you know, about being fair, just, etc. And laid down rules for how the government would not just collect tax, but also the application of that tax. Right? All these ideas are very, very, very advanced for the time that they were coined. Right? You look at our ancient texts again. Right? And again, I end up comparing West versus India simply because it is a great one-to-one comparison, right? If you ask any pure capitalist or a PhD or whatever in the US or Europe or Russia or Middle East or wherever, you ask them what is wealth. They'll say, oh, wealth is money. You know, wealth is assets. There is land. If I have land, if I have a factory, if I have vehicles, if I have cash in the bank, if I have bars of gold, that is all wealth. Wealth has been a unidimensional perspective within capitalist and communist frameworks. Within the Dharmicism framework, there are 8 different types of wealth that we always knew about. So Adi Lakshmi was primary wealth, right? There was also Dhanalakshmi, Dhani Lakshmi, Veera Lakshmi, right? Santana Lakshmi, Aishwarya Lakshmi. So the fact that wealth is not just about money, but it is about the security of food grain. There is specifically a wealth of courage, Veera Lakshmi. There is Santana Lakshmi, the wealth of offspring. You see, none of these kinds of wealth, right? The fact that you have courage, the fact that you have security in your food grain, the fact that you have affluence, the fact that you have victory, Vijay Lakshmi as an example, is the wealth of victory. All of these are non-monetary wealths, but they are wealths. Now, with companies realizing that unidimensional dollar measures are not enough ways of measuring a company's success. Sridhar Vembu wrote a very good response to, I think, Fortune or whatever, which is also available online. When they said, we'd want to rank you in top 50 and this and that. He says, you have a unidimensional measure, right? Which is, how much money do I have? That's only a small part of what we are creating here. We are creating a lot of other things. Now, why is this whole idea of wealth important, of many types of wealth? Because from here, you derive the whole idea of corporate social responsibility, as we always knew it, versus an alien idea, which is, you pay your 2%, your job is done. Right? The whole idea of dana, the whole idea of punyakamana, the whole idea of punyakamana is no different from the carbon credits that we hear of nowadays, right? What is Punya Kamana? I am doing something which is somehow either hurting the planet or the ecology or my community or whatever else. To offset that, I need to do some good for the same community, for the same society, for the planet. I will plant trees. I will build a dharmashala. I will build a school. I will donate to a temple, etc., etc. Right? Because of this cultural understanding of dharmicism, which nobody needed to teach us, much before the whole Greta Thunberg and this and that happened, much before carbon credits and ecological consciousness and all of that, you had the Chipko movement happening in India, which is to say that this tree is an integral part of my life. To cut that tree, you will have to go over my dead body. That, you know, that to me is true CSR, right? Versus Western companies who will donate amount to an NGO and say our responsibility for CSR is done. Indian companies that were rooted in our dharmic DNA, they have built townships, they have built hospitals, they have built schools, right? None of us, and I challenge you, none of us would have spent our lives not being a recipient or a beneficiary of some kind of institution or program or social benefit, which has been built by truly Indian corporates. That's the impact that traditional Indian CSR has had, right? You see, I always talk about the example of Akshay Patra. You see, Akshay Patra is a brilliant example. It's the world's largest soup kitchen and runs without government support, without this, that, without even calling it as CSR, right? We need to remember that, these existed in our cultural DNA for thousands of years before the word or phrase CSR was even coined. You see, even a small, you know, we have Buddy or Kottu or Pansari or whatever you call it, right? A small grocery fellow, especially in North India, they'll have a small matka, a pot outside their shop with a glass on it. Why? Any passerby who's feeling very hot in the summer, he's getting dehydrated, he can drink a glass of water and go. If nothing, people will put out a bowl of rice or roti or whatever for a crow to eat. These things don't have to be taught to us through a Western lens. These things are intrinsically and internally a part of our DNA, right? Now, shifting gears a little bit, you know, we have talked about the history of dharmicism in India. We have talked about how we were invaded because dharmicism was successful. We have compared it to the emerging Western way of thought, which is very, very recent, you know, startups, tech companies, et cetera, et cetera. You look at the traditional Western economic model, right? Across the US and Western Europe, unemployment is at the highest today. Wages are stagnant. Work conditions are inhumane. You look at China, who's emerging as an economic power. That level of inhumanity is unsustainable in the long term. You talk to an average friend who's in the US or UK or Western Europe, they will tell you that they're in so much of student debt and household debt and car debt and all, it's not even funny. Right? Like I said in the beginning, 99% of capitalist society today is literally living mouth to mouth. If a paycheck doesn't come for 2 months or 3 months, those families have the likelihood of going bankrupt. The last 1 month, I think, saw the unemployment numbers in the US go up 6x to unsustainable levels. Right? Now, why does this happen? There is quarter to quarter pressure. There is a single, a single unit of measurement, right? There is no long-term view. Right? Every CEO is thinking about performance, not even on a yearly or quarterly term, on a monthly term. Why? Because the board is demanding, the stock market is demanding, etc., etc. Right? Financial markets, who are themselves dying, is not able to support companies that are also dying. Right? Very recently, you would have heard, and again, all of this new thought is emerging from the Silicon Valley. You've heard of concepts like conscious capitalism and impact investing and giving pledge, which Warren Buffett and Bill Gates have started and things like that. All of these, the fact that people feel that they have to somehow make up for the damage that they're causing to the society and the earth, is, in my view, some kind of a guilt-ridden approach. It is to say that, hey, listen, I'm actually doing something or somebody some harm. So let me be a conscious capitalist, right? Or I'm putting my money in terrible places, so let me get into impact investing, right? Or, oh, I've made so much money, whether I deserve it or not is besides the point. So I have to sign up to a giving pledge to give it to the less fortunate. Not thinking about, hey, you created the less fortunate in the first place, right? So across the world, you can see that the whole, so if you look at Keynes, the whole idea of capitalism was premised on Keynes's learning. So he had this whole idea of animal spirit. Now we can see this whole animal spirit is becoming a little more humane. It is not, people are saying, hey, we don't have to be cutthroat. We don't have to think in terms of zero game, that for me to win, you have to lose. All these ideas are now taking root, even in purely capitalist economies, right? So where does that leave India? And with this, I would like to conclude in another 3-4 minutes or so. You see, nations or political boundaries are formed with brute force. You and I wage a war. I am more powerful than you. I kill more of your people than you kill of mine. Therefore, your piece of land becomes my piece of land. Over ages, we draw a boundary somewhere, we set up a UN, we legitimize that line on the sand and say, oh, this is a nation. So nations have always been about brute force, right? Civilizations, on the other hand, are formed on the basis of ideas. Now, if we need our civilization to reemerge, we need our ideas to take root, right? I'll give you a couple of simple examples. You can peek into your own experiences or your children's experiences or whatever it is. The USA today is considered very cool and hip, right? Why? Because their idea was a cultural idea which they have exported to the rest of the world, right? Cultural idea in terms of Hollywood movies, in terms of, jeans and t-shirts, in terms of the food that we like to eat, our kids like to eat. All of these are cultural ideas. The USA has been able to export those cultural ideas and has been able to establish itself because of that. You look at the UK as an example. Forget where they are today, but over the last 200 years, they have been able to export their model of governance. So their idea was, this is how you govern a society. That governance model through the Commonwealth, etc., remnants of that continue till today. The idea still that they exported was that of governance. You look at countries like Germany and Korea and Japan and Taiwan. They are relevant today because what is their idea? Their idea is that of the professional work ethic, right? Of if I have to say it in our words, the whole idea of let's say Kshatriyata or Purusharth in economic terms or in work terms has been exported by Japan and Germany and so on. So you see, the point I'm making is USA gained its power from a cultural idea. UK from an idea of governance. Germany, Japan from the idea of professionalism, right? My submission is that it's time for India to also create and invest and export in an idea of our own. You see, a whole bunch of people on this side and that side of the political horizon keep talking about idea of India, idea of India, idea of India. But what really is the idea of India, right? In my view, the economic model, which is based on sustainability, which is based on fairness, which is based on long-term profits, which is based on profits, which is based around people, is an idea whose time has come. it is the idea for which the world, I mean, if you look at the gaps of capitalism and communism, the things that turn people off the most against capitalism are resolved if we take ancient economic ideas from India, right? Now, I'm not saying that we should blindly take principles from, you know, 500 years back or 5,000 years back and just blindly reapply them today. But I believe that there is a lot of learning that can be made, right? So let me, you know, so we have an opportunity to pick and choose is my point. Let's take a few areas where on how dharmicism is different from capitalism and communism, or rather the disadvantages of capitalism or communism that is being solved because of dharmicism, right? In capitalism, you have the risk takers who create wealth for themselves. In communism, you don't have risk takers at all. What does dharmicism say? Dharmicism says, because we need wealth creators, we need people who take risks, right? But they create wealth for themselves and society. Where capitalism and communism are extreme ends of individual rights versus community rights. Dharmicism is never about rights at all. It is not about me saying what I want from the world. It is about individual responsibility. It is about saying what is my responsibility as a businessman, as a farmer, as a wealth creator to society. Right? Versus a culture of consumption that the West is focused on. Dharmicism focuses on preservation. All the green ecology, climate change warriors today would find a model to which preservation is central. They would find this model so exciting if it is presented to them in the right format. Right? Now, Dharmicism has always been about free market. So nobody is saying that you should go back into command and control socialist kind of this thing, right? But the idea of free market is there is a free market for me to truly create value, extract it, to be able to fulfill my dharma or to be able to fulfill my responsibilities. That is the ultimate aim. Not just saying that my net worth is so much, your net worth is so much, right? Money as a measurement is perhaps a very archaic concept, right? Think about how much the world would change. And I'm not trying to be very kind of bohemian or utopian here. Think of how much the world would change if your net worth was measured in the amount of blessings you got, not how much money you had in the bank. Now, that might sound like a very extreme concept to many, but if you see what Bill Gates is doing today or what Warren Buffett is doing today, that's essentially what they are doing today. They're saying, look, I have my money. This money is meaningless by itself. Let me see what good I can create out of it, which is fundamentally a very dharmic view, right? You know, so the whole idea is to incentivize people to invest, to do business, to earn money, to grow, to do all the things that capitalism asks for, but with a trusteeship focus, rather than with a greed and a focus of appropriation. The fundamental difference between, let's say, capitalism and dharmicism is, capitalism only believes in a zero-sum game. Right, that there is totally so much money on the table. Either you get to keep it or I get to keep it. If I have to win, you have to lose. Dharmicism doesn't believe in a zero-sum game. Dharmicism is fundamentally expansionist in the assumption. Going back to the statement of Kautilya, that a human being can create value out of land or anything for that matter. Right? More importantly, for us as Indians, it's a very important time for us to recognize, you know, now we're coming out of poverty. We're coming out of a command and control economy. There's enough food to feed people. There's enough, you know, so we've taken care of all the basic humanitarian needs. Now it is time for us to acknowledge higher order needs or intellectual needs to say that, look, we can evolve as a nation or we can evolve as a civilization only if we recognize the continuity. Right. See, in the long history of time, 100, 200, 300 years is nothing, right? Unless we recognize that there is an ancient wisdom, there is an ancient cultural rooting. There are cultural and economic and business practices which we need to build continuity, which we need to continue on for us to unlock our true potential. Unless that happens, we will internally not be able to, India will not be able to be that Vishwaguru or Soni ki Chidiya that it deserves to be. At the same time, we lose the whole opportunity to presenting an alternative to the world, given that the current alternatives anyway doesn't work. So I just submit in all of this, that if we really want to be Vishwaguru, if we really want ourselves as an economy or as a society to grow, the only way to do it is to recognize the whole idea of dharmicism and to internalize it in our laws, our taxation system, our way of working, and then export it to the rest of the world. With that, I end my comments. Back to Giridharji. Thank you so much for patiently listening to me. Now, I'm more than open to any thoughts, questions, whatever you might have.
Yeah, thanks for the initial comments, Anuragji. The concepts that you are espousing, suppose we superimpose them on today's economic scenario specifically, and then we try and see how the differences pan out. Let's say, for instance, for argument's sake, let's say we take about the doles that the government of India is giving, right? Free this, free that, whatever. Your food subsidies, your Manrega, whatnot. There's so many things we are giving free, right? But that was not the concept envisaged by, let's say, Kautilya. The intervention of the state was only in terms of endemics, pandemics, or emergencies. Otherwise, the market forces were left alone, and the state was only concerned about the safety and security. So, how do you view these from a dharmicism point of view in what's happening today?
You see, that's a very interesting question. That, in fact, let me rephrase and expand that question. That what does the practical implication of dharmicism look like? Right. Now, take a couple of areas. Look at taxation. Right. Historically, I'm literally quoting from text. Right. The whole idea of tax was to be like the honeybee that sucks nectar from a flower. You look at the taxation system we have today. I know of businesses that have to be shut down. I know of businessmen that end up paying from their own pockets, etc., etc. A, the amount of taxation, B, the delivery. We've all heard about tax terrorism, tax jihad, all these things are reality. It is nowhere, rather than being a honeybee, they've become locusts, which destroys the flower and the crop and the plant and the field itself. So that could be one example. Second example, if you, like I mentioned, the whole idea of role of the government. Right? The government was supposed to govern, business was supposed to do business. The clarity was very, very clear, exactly as you mentioned. Again, I don't say I have all the answers and what is right or not right. I see no reason. You look at, in fact, in my view, Margaret Thatcher followed dharmicism more than we have followed it. Why? Because she stood up and said, boss, it's not the government's job to run trains. It's not the government's job to, get food to your table or run airplanes or run restaurants or whatever it is. So we will slowly get out of that so we can redirect our effort towards governing better, right? And leave all this to private enterprise, which, again, take India's example. Private enterprise has historically been way more efficient than public enterprise. Public enterprise has the ability to do good because taxpayers fund it. There is no case where the public enterprise is actually more efficient than a private enterprise. Take the whole example of, let's say, the relative importance or roles of various creators, right? The whole idea of nuance or artistry has gone away because of pushing for mass manufacturing, because of pushing to a factory model, etc. which is therefore then leading to urbanization, right? And you see, urbanization per se is not a bad word, but you know, let's use the example of Hyderabad. Hyderabad, around the time I used to know it, the city used to end at Banjara Hills, Jubilee Hills, which is why Secret Lake was called Secret Lake to begin with, right? You have brought in people from all over the country, you know, to first set up High Tech City, then Gachibowli, then Nallagantla, and then now Sarlingampally. You know, it's grown all over the place. Nothing which exists in Hyderabad could not have existed in a smaller town or in a distributed fashion, right? People move from a village to a town. And again, in the COVID crisis, we are seeing the worst elements of this, right? Half of the risk is created. Of course, there are some people who want to go spit on others and willingly subject themselves and put others to risk, which is a bigger cultural issue. But from an economic perspective, all these people from Bihar and UP and Orissa that have, you know, that were in Delhi, Bombay, etc., were there because of unhindered urbanization. Why? Because we did not internalize the whole philosophy of rural economies, right? Why did that happen? Because, you know, when the British came in, they said that, so they used to go to churches. Churches was a place of worship, right? It was a religious building to them. So they went to a temple and they said, oh, temple also is a religious building. Right? Temple was never meant to be a religious building alone. There were gurukuls there. There were cases that were adjudicated there. Arbitration used to happen. There used to be a weekly, monthly market. It used to be the center for arts, performance, teaching, etc., etc. Temple was a community center, not a religious center, right? Now you've taken that away from the community and you've given it to the government, who are following a Britisher's definition of a temple, and they've made it only into a religious place. The whole rural economy has broken. People have no money. What will they do? They have to come to the center and they'll become your driver, your cleaner and your cook and so on and so forth, right? So there are a lot of principles at a fiscal level, at an economic level, at an urban development level that can be reapplied. What we need to first figure out is, are we ambitious enough to do that or not? I don't know if that answers your question, Giridharji.
Yeah, so I mean, definitely it addresses a certain angle to it. The other one I'm looking at is, I think our civilizationally, we have gone from being one of the world's best known urban civilization to breaking away from the urbanized world into a rural setup. See, after the Mohenjo-Daro, Harappa major cities, we dispersed into the smaller villages with the same cultural edifice carried back to the villages, right? Now there is a huge urge to do the reverse of it, right? Bring people like what you said from Bihar, UP into urban conglomerates. And today the pandemic has really pushed the whole structure into a very bad shape. You know, probably Japan has managed to some extent stave off people in their villages, take the technology into the villages and not bring the people into the cities, right? Yep. You know, I think we look back at even the drainage management that we had in those cities. I don't think we have managed anything close to that in any city in the world today.
Yeah.
So somewhere, I think the way we connected with town planning and, you know, environmental issues, this was something which I think it needs a serious revisit. And we somehow need to again look at how do we empower our villages, how do we go back to the villages and decongest the cities. After all, in the past 20, 25 days, each house is a village in a way. I mean, we are locked in and then you're getting all the services, right? Mm-hmm. So why can't this happen? The ancient wisdom of not having to live in major cities, but then take the entire culture into the smaller villages is something which probably, you know, that's a concept you want to speak about. The whole idea is there is collectivism versus individually I'm going to prosper versus collective Absolutely. Good of everybody. You know, that's what I think I'm trying
that is,
to.
You hit the nail on the head, sir. That is exactly the key. You know, to recognize that I as an individual is irrelevant or cannot prosper unless people around me prosper. You see, I'll give you a simple example of relative. So there's a very interesting book called The Coming Anarchy by Kenichi Ohmae. Now, that book says that, and Kenichi Ohmae, of course, is one of the biggest social thinkers and consultants and economists. He said that violence or social unrest does not happen because of poverty. It happens because of relative poverty. If you and I are both poor, okay, I'm just giving an example. You and I and say Raghu Garu are all poor. All of us are happy. We are there with each other. Evening, we'll sit, we'll play cards. You know, we'll sit under the banyan tree. We'll tell stories to each other. We'll go home. Now, Raghu Garu becomes rich, which is actually true. You and I will sit and develop negative emotions towards Raghu Garu. You and I will say, hey, what the heck, this, that, whatever, whatever. And that is where violence stems from. Now, I saw this example when I was living in Mumbai. I was living in Hiranandani. Next to Hiranandani, on one side, there is a slum in the Vikhroli side. On the other side, there is Chandivali, which is a middle-class kind of society. There was no problem in Vikhroli, Chandivali, whatever, till Hiranandani came in between. Now, Hiranandani was this, you know, you have lots of offices there, relatively richer people stay there kind of thing. The minute Hiranandani came up, violence started, chain snatching started, you know, robbery started in houses, etc., etc. Till then, people living around were not unhappy with who they were. Now, the whole idea of dharmicism, in my view, is to be able to recognize that individual prosperity is not sustainable. It is just not sustainable, which is a reality. And except that businessmen realize that when by the time they come to the age of 60, 65, 70, whatever it is, the society is realizing it. I mean, the whole green movement or climate change movement is premised on a simple realization that our kind of capitalism, you know, forget communities or cities or even countries, the world itself is failing. It doesn't matter how much money you have in your bank account if we all go up in flames. So I think very good points raised there, sir.
Yeah, I think the concept that Chanakya espoused was Artha, Kama and Moksha, all three cannot be earned unless it is backed by Dharma.
Correct. Absolutely. So
that is the concept that he spoke about. So this, we apply it in the economic context, right? This concept of sparda, what we say, you know, in the current current capitalistic thing, that, you know, it's an unsustainable competition where, you know, I kill somebody and somebody kills me, you know.
Yeah.
Instead, I respect that, the Dharma tells me that I have to respect the right of everyone to grow.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? That's a concept, I think, is what ultimately needs to be looked at.
Absolutely, sir.
And I think, see, the other one is like the concept of insurance, for instance. Insurance and social security, these concepts are all stemming from the experience of non-community based individuals coming together in a country like USA. They passed on the risk factors to the government or the insurance companies. Whereas in a country like India, our family structures, our community structures, you call it caste structures or whatever it is, these were the protecting layers for us.
Absolutely.
So, the very concept of your dharmic way of life ensured a lot of security to us, internal security. So I think somewhere we need to bring this into monetary terms Probably India would not be considered as poor as what they want to look at it as. The balance sheet that is prepared of any country is driven by the Western concept, Western models. Whereas these intrinsic value and dharmic systems of the country are not really monetized. Isn't it?
True, absolutely. In fact, I'll give you a very recent example. Tirupur has a huge, textile manufacturing industry. Now, something that I got involved with very, very recently, a few days back. You have small business owners there that run ancillary services to these textile manufacturers. For example, you have Tempo, you have people that run Tempos. So they buy 6 to 8 or 10 tempos, they hire a few people, and they keep running these tempos on shift to deliver, thread and buttons and boxes and thermocol and this and that. Now, all their earning has gone down to zero since this lockdown started. However, this fellow has to pay EMI on that tempo. He has to pay a salary to the drivers, etc., etc. He stood up and said, boss, he went to the bank and said, look, I cannot pay you anymore. So you want to take repossession of the tempos, please do it. Anyway, I'm not earning money. These manufacturers, they got together. They said, boss, we will pool in money because the bank is not willing to help you. Government is not willing to help you. Nobody is willing to help you, but our community will help you. We will give you the money to pay the EMIs, to pay the salaries, not for your family, but just so that you do not go bankrupt. 2, 3, 4 months later, when our production starts again, you cut it from our bill for the next 6 months. Right? Now, no form of economics will account for behavior like this. Yeah. However, this is part of our cultural DNA. You don't need Adam Smith or John Maynard Keynes to tell you to do this. You do this because it is a part of dharma. You do this because you understand coexistence. You do this because you understand interdependence. You do this because you understand the idea of seva swadhyaya. Right? So you're absolutely right. It is inseparable from us. It is just, so many businessmen tell me that from a business practices point of view, they're following good old dharmic practices. From an accounting perspective, they're following whatever Western principles they have to follow.
Yeah.
Right? On the new year, on the first day, you go and put 1 rupee in the account of whoever you believe in.
Yeah, God account.
Fit to God account. Yeah, all those practices are still there. Yeah. We just have to recognize that reality as a nation and say, that is who we are. We will accept who we are. We don't need to be a Xerox copy of some other country in the West.
Yeah, even the concept of NPA, for instance, like what you said, quarter on quarter, you are bound to show whatever growth and all. So the moment you cross that 180 days threshold or whatever it is, you are pushed into an NPA, irrespective of the fact that businesses can have cycles, which need not be annual cycles. It could be 2, 3 year cycles as well. Sometimes they dip, sometimes they go up. That is what we saw in couple of episodes that have happened in the last 6 years. Demonetization, for instance. It was the Hindu dharma, the basic dharma which protected this country during that time. People didn't pay cash, but they said, okay, it's okay. We will, we will live with it. You don't have to pay cash. We can take it once the cash liquidity picks up, right? So similarly, during this COVID crisis also, governmental efforts, we don't know how successful they are, but almost everybody is coming and giving something, they're feeding somebody, they're donating something, they're giving free food to people. So that kind of an automatic community responsibility is something which is ingrained in us. That needs to be monetized. What I'm saying is this has to be brought out in economic terms, in value terms, in terms of the way we live, the way we run our economy. That is wholesomely missing. I think you're muted.
Just got unmuted. Yeah, totally agree, sir. Absolutely agree with all your points.
Yeah. So I think let's start taking questions and then.
There was one question which I don't know, somebody posted on the chat earlier saying that, okay, this is Ram Mohan Garu. I said, Anuragji did not touch on socialism / mixed economy. I think that's a beautiful question, sir. Okay, the idea of socialism or mixed economy is this, right? It is supposed to be a hybrid between capitalism and communism. If capitalism has failed, if communism has failed, a bastard child of them will fail. If A is not sustainable, B is not sustainable, then A plus B by 2 is also not sustainable. So that's a simple response to that, sir.
True, true. Lakshmanan Garu, please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, good evening, Mr. Anurag. It has been a very interesting topic.
Namaste.
And namaste. This dharmakism, what you are talking about, because I always keep telling people about the USP of different countries. Because you talked about the same thing, USP of US, USP of UK, Germany and other things. I always say USP of India is spirituality.
Correct.
Yeah. So that means again, through this dharmakism, we want to bring in the spirituality part of it into the our lives. Because there is a lot of confusion about the spirituality in many people. Mm-hmm. Because going to temples, doing pujas, people think it is as a spirituality. But we need to go into the basic spirituality part of it, and it needs to be inculcated in the people. Now, if you see the present education system in the country, especially in the Telugu-speaking states, where the whole concept of education has gone to dogs, and it is only getting ranks and marks and getting a job and earning money. So, what needs to be done? I basically feel that we should need to have a better education system. And also, we need to have a better spirituality and the understanding of the people about the wealth. Suppose if you go to any place and ask somebody who is the greatest man here, they talk about the richest man living in that area. They don't talk about a person who is doing some service to the society. So the basic thought process of the people need to be changed. And my this thing is how you correlate these dharmakism with Maslow's need hierarchy, and also how this education system needs a change, or what suggestions you make. Thank you very much.
Again, very wonderful set of questions, sir. I will start with the education first, education system first. Again, like I mentioned in the beginning, I am not an intellectual, so I do not believe in... So there are two, three things which we need to get out of. First of all, we need to stop claiming victimhood. We need to stop stating the problem. We all know what Macaulay did. We all know what our historians did. We all know the deficiencies in the system. We all know the outcome of the deficiency in the system, right? How do we collectively respond? That is where my problem is. How do we collectively respond? We go on Twitter and we shout. We go on Facebook and we shout. Then we sit together and we discuss what we would call katha kala chepam. So there is a lot of that happening, right? Somebody who chooses to act, what does he do? Out of, let's say, 100 distortions in history, they will pick up 10 of them that offend them the most, right? Then three things: petitions, pleas, and protest. The three P's of our people: petitions, pleas, protest. They'll write a petition, it will go into the dustbin. They will file a plea in the court. They may or may not win. Worst case, if they want to move out of their armchair activism, they'll go and protest somewhere. So out of 100 issues, they anyway have acted on 10. Out of 10, they might be successful in 2 or 3. What has therefore happened? And then they celebrate it as if it is a victory. Oh, we got CBSE to change this and that and blah, blah, blah. It is actually not a victory. It is a defeat, because 97 out of the 100 distortions are still there. We should be ashamed rather than be proud of the approach that is followed. Now, what would we do if we had been ambitious? Our response would have been, forget all this. We will set up a new education board of our own. India today has 52 education boards. the largest education board. So India has 14.5 lakh schools. Out of 14.5 lakh schools, CBSE has about 16,000-17,000 schools, being the largest national board. So think, it's hardly 1% of the total number of schools. Of course, local boards, you know, metric and this and that would be large in terms of numbers, but I'm talking of national boards here. The single largest national board is CBSE with about 16,000-17,000 schools. The second largest national board is ICSE with about 1,800 schools. That's it. ICSE teaches you Bible legitimately as a part of your moral science class, right? It is run by the Anglo-Indian Society of India, etc., etc. So their cultural leanings are not secret for anyone, right? Many parents, teachers, and even school principals don't know that ICSE is an Anglo-Indian board. Now, my question is, we have understood this problem for so long, why have we not said we need a board of our own? So I think it is a lack of ambition, it is a lack of action, which leads us to the situation we are in today. Right. Now, this will not get resolved at all unless we are ambitious about our response. Right. If I have to lose weight, I should not say that I will drink my coffee without sugar. I have to exercise also. I have to stop eating babatlu also. I have to stop eating cakes, pastries, right? A whole bunch of things needs to be done. We refuse to do that. We stick to either discussions or symbolism, right? Sorry, what was your other question, sir?
I was talking about this Maslow's theory because it comes as a self-actualization. I mean,
yeah. So yeah. if you look at Maslow's need hierarchy theory, of course there is. You see, there is D.K. Hariji and Hemaji, his wife, who have done a lot of research on Maslow, his cultural routings, which can be traced back. So there is a theory that his cultural routing were traced back to India, and that Maslow's need hierarchy theory in exactly that five-step format is actually rooted or found in Indian ancient texts as well. But the whole idea of dharmicism is absolutely aligned to Maslow's need hierarchy theory, which is essentially you first worry about roti, kapda, makan.
Yeah.
Right. And if you look at the whole need hierarchy theory, it is a theory of human evolution per se. Right. All humans have the core need of roti, kapda, makan, which is largely shared by animals as well. Anything else is your process of seeking or growth beyond that. I see no incompatibility between that, you know, again, we go back into mentioning Bill Gates and Warren Buffett all the time. But these people, for all practical purposes, are self-actualized. They are self-actualized because they've gone through the first four phases.
Four things.
Right. So yeah, I don't see any incompatibility at all.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Professor J. Smurthy.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you are.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Anuragji, I think you have touched upon a point which is apparently not relevant to the present times. But such concepts, I think Gandhiji said, that is what is called trusteeship. And the Dindayalji has given this integral humanism in that economics point also touched upon. And then there are several theories from communist side and all those things. Okay. Now we are rooted in this country. We are all culturally a little bit evolved. And we feel so. And we express our thoughts and actions. As you said, in this country, we all know at least daily 1 crore or 2 crores of people are fed free in this country and nowhere else in the whole world. Every day it happens now, including Akshay Patra and several Tirupati Devasthanam, and there are several Dharma Satras and all that. Yes. And this is not, it is a practice in our country through ages. Okay. Mm-hmm. but how this can be fit into the economic theory or economic practices. So theory part is different, and in this present system of so-called democratic government, which you have ourselves chosen, how to fit into these things, that is the real question. That is the real crux. And then if it is left to people, see, that's why I personally, I know several business people, they avoid tax and they do all these dharmic activities because they feel if I give this government, all this will go to corrupt channels. Let me do my own thing directly service to the, that is their thought. So this, and this comes under dharmicism. So how to correlate these things? And you know, this is an idea is very good, ideal. But the thing is, the once you are proposing tantra, that's how you have triggered the minds of certain people like us, some intellectuals. And can we, do you think that can be given some kind of shape to put into practice through government channels? Can you see it in the near future? Otherwise, what is the result or what is the solution for this?
Again, a very good question, Murthy Garu. So let me start with a small personal experience as to why I'm now thinking on something which is and should be considered extremely ambitious. Few years back, as Giridharji mentioned, I started the India Pride project. Now, around the time that I started the India Pride project, I was just one average guy. I'm a chartered accountant from India, did my MBA in the US and things like that. And, just a regular job and things like that. At that time, if somebody had told me only that, look, Anurag, you'll be able to help the government in bringing back stolen murtis and antiquities and heritage. If somebody had told me that, that foreign governments will be talking about the work that you've done, or Washington Post or BBC or whatever would like the work you've done, that you would in any way be relevant to the political establishment, to the policy establishment, I only would have laughed on them. Now, why am I telling you this? Because I believe that it is possible to be hugely ambitious and to think in terms of a step change rather than in terms of an incremental change. Now, coming back to your specific question around, okay, this idea is okay, parledu. How do we take this to conclusion? Now, the thing with any kind of an idea, if you were to look at the life journey of an idea itself, right? The idea spreads till it either matters to a majority of the population, or it matters to the establishment. That is the process that we have to work on now. Once that happens, it is not a small journey. It is not something that we will resolve in 2 years or 20 years, perhaps not even in my lifetime.
Right.
But you see a couple of other areas. Look at the diplomatic effort that India has made. 10 years back, India could not imagine that we would make the diplomatic effort or that we would take the steps that we're taking today diplomatically. Right? You look at mass changes on the commercial side. I'm not saying on the economic side, on the commercial side. 10, 20 years back, we could not have imagined, right? Who knew that Bajaj would be the biggest, Bajaj would become the market leader in Africa, right? Today, Bajaj is a market leader in Africa. So there is a lot of, in a lot of other areas, we're getting fairly ambitious. In this area, I believe once there is enough traction, once there are enough stakeholders that align with our way of thought, you know, like that businessman that you talked about, right? And I think, see, I'm not judging the businessman's action, right? In one way, I can see why he would feel that, why should I give this money away to a corrupt government that is likely to waste it? I would rather put it to use, even if it means putting it in the hundi at Tirupati. at least I know that it is being put to good use there, right? It is a self-imposed taxation in his own mind. The self-imposed taxation is coming. Why? Because he doesn't align to the Western model that is being imposed on him by the government, right? A story of 50, 70 years is a small story, sir. In 50, 70 years, if you're ambitious enough, we come up with our own models. And this will not come through some small legislation. It will not come through some CII or FICCI saying that, oh, we want this to change or that to change. It is a fundamental mindset shift. And that mindset shift will take ages. What we need to do is, A, put our collective thought out there for the world to see. B, help the world understand that, by the way, what you are following is actually dharmicism, right? I can safely tell you 10 out of the top 20 or top 30 Silicon Valley leaders today are following principles of dharmicism down to the T. They just need to know this is what they are doing, right? Which I agree has been our collective failure as India and Indians. You know, you go to the most posh coffee shops in Australia and France, they will sell you turmeric latte, which will be more expensive than coffee, right? They don't know that it is haldi doodh. Telling that story is something they need to understand. Take yoga as an example. Now you have weird things like Christian yoga, beer yoga, and I don't know what else. Because that story has not been told. That yoga is fundamentally a part of your evolution as a human being. It is not an exercise. It is something way beyond exercise. So as India grows, as we become more ambitious, as we start owning the narrative, as we start owning the ability to push our narrative, I would say those things will naturally happen. What we still need to do is to take individual responsibility and then push it on a larger, influence whoever we can around us to start talking about this as an idea, to start talking about this as a principle, till it gets to a time that it is accepted or adopted by the government and somebody acts on it. You see, which is why I use my project as an example, right? As Giridharji mentioned, in 70 years or 65 years since independence, till 5-6 years back, a total of 13 objects had been brought back. That's roughly one every 5 years. Today, we have 236 objects that have been offered back to India. The number is not the point. I think my bigger victory is this. See, there is a whole bunch of issues that we all care about. Dharmic issues, patriotic issues, nationalistic issues, right-wing issues, whatever you want to call them. I don't worry about labels. It could be right to education. It could be relocation of Kashmiri Pandits. It could be cleaning of distortions in history books. It could be that our murtis should come back to our temples. It could be that temples should be free of government control. There are all these issues, right? I would like you to do this exercise, and I'm not saying this as a mark of vanity or anything like that. As far as I know, our Mudda is the only Mudda that has support from the BJP, from the Congress, from Telugu Desam, from the AIDMK, you name it who. You see, today there is a situation where people who share our cultural principles are saying that, not enough has been done. How come Article 26 to 30 is still there? How come RTE is not implemented uniformly across all kinds of institutions, right? All that is being said. People are complaining today that our agenda has not been delivered. But on the other hand, when it comes to my specific agenda, you obviously have BJP MPs and a BJP government that is supporting it very visibly. You have Shashi Tharoor from Congress who's standing up in Parliament and supporting it. You have Murli Mohan from Telugu Desam Party who's standing and supporting it. You have Selvagappan ji from AIADMK who's standing up and supporting it in writing in Parliament, right? What we need to do is to build that kind of consensus. Once that consensus happens, it means that the opposition to your idea has died. And you won that narrative war, after which the practical implementation of that becomes easy. That's the stage we need to get to with dharmicism. 5 years back, nobody even knew that our God should be coming home. Today, you have political consensus across party lines that has been built. And personally, I believe that is my biggest victory, not that I brought back this murti or that murti. The fact that today there is no opposition to the idea itself is our biggest victory. Today, not just, you know, Swarajya and Op India and this and that, but whenever, you know, Quint and Scroll and BBC and Washington Post write about us, they support what we do. That is the real victory. If you are able to bring that kind of victory to the idea of dharmicism, the practical implementation becomes that much easier.
Yeah, great. Sureshji, Suresh Kochatil.
Yes.
Guru Garu, Dandalaya, Bagunnara?
Bagunnarandi.
So good to see your face and so good to see you smiling, sir.
Okay. Anurag, I had a question for you. I don't know, we both, you lead the India Pride project. It's great that, you know, I'm just speaking to Dr. Rangarajan today. He came to serve the migrant workers' lunch in Hafizpet. He bought a prasadam from the temple itself. It was so good to see that.
Oh, very nice.
Now, my question to you is very simple. I hail from Kerala, even though I grew up in Hyderabad. Kerala is a paradox today. You know, lakhs of Keralites have migrated to the Gulf from the 60s onwards, 70s onwards, when they found the oil there. Mm-hmm. And they are all over the world today, literally even on the moon. That's what it says. Mm-hmm. But what happened is, subsequently, when these Keralites left, there came a vacuum. There was nobody to do the menial jobs in Kerala, which the Keralites felt was beneath their dignity to do. And slowly, the Andhra people from Tamil Nadu started coming in. They took up that work. And then they kind of graduated up. Then came people from Andhra, and they also became the seniors. And then they brought in workers from Bengal and UP and Bihar and everywhere today. Today, entire Kerala is run by the Bengali, typically the Bengalis. You go to a petrol bunk, it's run by a bunk. You go to a restaurant, every steward is a Bengali or a UPite or whatever. The construction sector is totally dominated by the UPites. You name it, there's not a sector that is not dominated by, even the guy who climbs a coconut tree, who at one time was a prerogative of the trade union in Kerala, is today by the workers, by the Bengalis. So my question is very simple. When you say, we should stop the migration, we should ensure that people stay in the villages, don't you see a paradox here? Because you see one set of people leaving for another geography and another set of people coming to take the opportunity, because for them, Kerala is Dubai. And for Keralites, Dubai is Dubai. So where is this? How do we handle the situation? Because this migration is purely economic, nothing else.
Good question. So I'd like to give an emotional answer to your question, and I'm going to be very blunt. Historically, what has been the biggest social failure in India, and what is the emotional symbol or mark of that failure? The biggest failure in India has been that we recognize distance from native place as a mark of success. This is across the length and breadth of, you know, from Punjab down to Kerala, as you mentioned, right? The Punjabi from a small village wants to leave and go to Jalandhar. Then from there, he wants to leave and go to Amritsar. From there, he wants to go to Delhi or Bombay. Finally, end up in Canada. Same thing with a Keralite. Historically, you see, if two people grew up together, the fellow who has been able to go outside of India, even for a terrible menial job, is considered more successful than the fellow who has been able to reach only, say, Bombay. Who is considered to be more successful than the fellow who has been able to reach, say, only, let's say, Hyderabad. I'm talking of my case because I grew up in Vizag, right? Now, that paradox has come. Why? Because historically, we've never been able to take prosperity into a village. Why have we not taken prosperity into a village? A, because we never respected agriculture as a profession per se, right? B, the Britishers messed up the whole idea of landholding through the Tehsildar, Zamindar, Patta system, that as compared to how it traditionally used to exist. See, we have not put any effort on local artisan. You see, I live in Singapore. The more expensive product is the handmade, customized production, right? when I was a child, each of the shirt that I used to get stitched in a corner tailor used to be handmade and customized. Today, I have to pay 5 times the price of a normal shirt if I need a handmade and customized shirt. We never realized the value of that. What needs to happen at some stage, purely from a population and a demographics point of view, and again, I don't expect our Sarkari Babus to understand it or our politicians to deliver it anytime soon. We have to realize that you have to move production, organization, etc., back to a village just for the nation to be able to even sustain, forget prosper. I'll give you a couple of small examples here. You have huge production facilities and cold storages coming up in and around villages. Right? What used to happen only in the hubs ages back, today, bang in the middle of nowhere, you'll find a huge, 1 lakh square foot cold storage. Right? So, agri products is moving. Agri products manufacturing is moving in small ways. Right? So, today you might have let's say a mirchi masala, chili powder, which will have one brand on top. What you will not know is that there are 50 districts where, okay, maybe not 50, maybe 10, 12 different districts where that chili is being grown. It is being dried and powdered locally, being sent in bulk to a central hub where it is being packaged. These kind of things have started in small ways. You look at Dastakari Hat and what they do with high-end woven fabrics and with clothes, right? You might have a Dastakari Hat table mat, but the table mat is built under the is made under the supervision of somebody sitting in Delhi, but it is made in 50 different villages, right? It is happening in small and piecemeal ways. That's, I'm very interested to see how this whole COVID situation and work from home pans out. I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of small startup type enterprises say that, listen, you sit in your village, you work from wherever you want. Our sales office will be in Bangalore or Bombay or wherever it is. But you're absolutely right. I see it as a collective failure not to invest in the real Bharat, right? But to ape a Russian model that we'll have a big, we'll have a set of big factories, this, that, whatever. People will come from 500 kilometers away to work. We have not just legitimized the grand escape, as I call it, moving from your village to town, town to capital, capital to outside the country. We've not just legitimized it, we've actually made it very sexy and cool. But again, that is not a sustainable model, period.
Yeah, I think now hopefully the reverse would happen now that the oil is dried up. So all Malayalis are going to come back from the Gulf into Kerala. And they'll push out Rohingyas first, then Bengalis, then Telugu fellows.
So the problem is climbing. We don't want to
work. Sureshji, let me complete. And Gulf returnees will be climbing the coconuts for you. Don't worry.
No, they don't want to do that work. That's a problem. They consider that as very menial. But they'll go to the Gulf and do the same job there because nobody notices them doing it. That is a problem.
I'm telling you that is history now. With the petrol prices going down below 20, you see a mass return back. People are going to be pushed out. The whole electric car and ecosystem is going to change. We are not going to be the same world after COVID. We're going to be a different world. You would see mass reverse migration happening. Kerala would be flooded with all these guys. And then obviously there will be social unrest and they'll throw out first Rohingyas, Bengalis, Telugu fellows, and the same fellow will climb the coconut tree. Don't worry about it. Thank you. Next is, I think, Dheeraj, Sandeep. Sandeep ji, please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah, Sandeep ji. Sandeep.
Hi. Girdhar ji, first of all, thank you for this wonderful topic. My first question to, I have 2 to 3 questions. 2 will be very simple and 3rd will be a little lengthy. First question is...
Ask me the easy question, sir. I was terrible at school. Please ask me the easy question.
Would you just give us some beginner reference textbook or some sort of thing on this Dharmikism? First question. The second question is, What do you think is the unit of prosperity in the in this Dharmikism, you know, concept? Like, would you see family as the basis of prosperity, or is a society or the other way of looking at as prosperity? That's the second question. And third question is, how do you see a cooperative system, you know, fitting in this whole, you know, Dharmikism idea?
Super. Now, okay, I'm just making a note of these. Okay, so first, textbook, unfortunately, there is none. You know, historically, even after independence, we have been so ashamed of indigenous wisdom and Indic models that nobody has bothered to write anything about it. Which is why I took a shot at it by writing an article. Actually, Giridharji, would it be possible to share that, if I send you a link, would it be possible to share it with Sandeepji or maybe with everybody on this call?
Yeah, we can post it. You can post it to everyone here. That's possible. But anyway, answering it.
This whole chat will, you know, it will just scroll up.
Yeah, don't worry. You keep answering. I'll look for it and I'll post it. Yeah.
Sure. No, separately, email kar dijiye. I would recommend. If at all you can, or if you have a WhatsApp group or something.
Yeah.
But anyway, so A, boss, there is no textbook. The idea of bringing it up to you, Sandeep ji, and with everybody is that we need to collectively come up with this model, right? The wisdom exists in bits and pieces. The closest I would think of a textbook would be the Arthashastra. Please read it, right? Interestingly, there are a whole bunch of, I would not say the Mahabharata, but sections of the Mahabharata. Right.
Posted the article.
Okay, very good. And then, no, this is a different article, boss. I will send you, or just Google for Dharmikism. I'll send it to you later.
Okay.
The point of what was I saying? If you look at the treatise of Bhishma on his deathbed, that is a beautiful. You know, people focus on the Bhagavad Gita instead. Huge learnings from there in terms of governance models, economics, king's duty, citizens' duties, etc., etc. So Arthashastra and Bhishma would be the two reference points. But beyond that, we have to contextualize it and modernize it to come up with our own. So that's the answer to question number one. Answer to question number two, unit of prosperity. When you say family or society, that's my point. The whole idea of either or is a Western notion. The whole idea of Dharmikism is that either or does not exist because prosperity is not finite. Prosperity is infinite, exactly like wisdom is infinite. We have just not found a way to tap into infinite prosperity, right? Interestingly, if you look at a lot of the younger people today, right, there'll be some fellow who's earning 1 lakh a month. He believes he can get his next job for 2 lakhs a month. He doesn't think like us that his next increment will be 5%, right? That newness of endless prosperity, of abundance, as the West calls it nowadays, you know, you have the secret and this and that, they keep introducing the concept of abundance, or whatever. That is the fundamental belief that I'm talking about. That if you believe in abundance, you will not say whether it is family versus society or whatever it is. Why? Because it is possible for everybody to prosper at par, not equally, but at the same time, right? Let me give you a slightly digressed response to the whole family idea. Take the whole idea of Hindu undivided family as a legal concept, as an economic concept. An equivalent of this doesn't exist anywhere in the world. If you look at foundationally the de-risking that an HUF allows for, I'm not talking about it from a tax perspective, but just from the concept and the ideological perspective. The whole idea of an HUF is interestingly an Indian concept. You removed that or diluted that and you brought in sole proprietorship, partnership, company, this, that, whatever it is, and replaced a wonderful unit that was already working with something which is bound to fail, right? And that's the idea that I'm talking about. On your third question, the cooperative system, yes, I think the cooperative system is exactly what I'm saying, subject to one caveat. A cooperative system, it is very easy for a cooperative system to slide towards a communism kind of a system where everybody pools in resources, but the resources are managed by a few. If you can ensure that that doesn't happen, that power rests with all members, then it would be very close to the whole idea of dharmicism that I'm talking about.
Yeah, I think on the cooperative structure, we have two models. See, most of the cooperative movement in India failed because these elections and communism union came in and then they killed it. Again, the concept of binary where I win, you lose kind of a thing happened there, and people spent a lot of money to win these posts in the cooperatives, and you know, that kind of killed it. But we have two models. One, of course, is the Anand model, where your ownership only to the extent of getting the benefits out of it or the losses, but then you leave the management to a professional team, right? Probably that worked. That's the only thing, that's the only success story in India, others have failed. Second model is probably what we see in Udupi. Udupi Krishna temple, there are 6 or 7 mutts who take turns in taking responsibility of the temple management year on year. So it is not that, you know, one of them has to win an election and then dominate or run it. It's a collective thing. So probably in a cooperative, if you have some kind of a rotational system where all stakeholders get to taking the decision, being the decision makers at some point in time, probably it'll run. The moment you put this competitiveness of election, then it is dead. You're killing it. That is not part of Indian way of looking at it. The very concept of cooperatives, you're cooperating. You're not competing, right? When the competition comes in, you're killing it. That's my view on, the way we look at it. Probably we need to redefine the whole concept of cooperatives and, this structure from an Indian perspective, not the models that are existing outside there. And the second point is Pragya Bharati, after we had a pre-budget discussion, we submitted a note to the finance ministry where we recommended that, like your Hindu undivided family, maybe you make it Indian undivided family. Even Muslims are there. It could be Christians. It could be anybody else. A family unit needs to be respected in this country, and a family business needs to be respected, right? So in case you still have to live with a corporate umbrella, then please create a concept where family corporates are different and they are not subjected to some of these stupid rules which apply to a normal corporate. So we suggested that we start thinking in terms of family as a unit and expand it to probably a community or a village as we go down the road. We suggested, but it's very preliminary in stage. Maybe once you come out with your book, maybe we can expand it further.
Okay.
Yeah. Rajesh ji, go ahead. Yeah.
Namaskar, sir. This is Rajesh.
Namaste, sir.
Sir, I have a couple of questions what we have discussed earlier. One is the education system and the education boards, what you have mentioned. So how best we can do the dharmic education included in the present education system and create a separate board? Just like once upon a time, we used to have a Hindu Dharma Rakshana Parishad kind of a thing in TTD, which used to publish all dharmic books, but never included, actually involved in educating or creation of education system or schools for a dharmic things. Can we do that? Can actually, if legally it is permissible, or how best we can actually get a recognition for if we set up that kind of a board is one. And second is the urbanization, what we have actually discussed about during this COVID, especially the migration and all these things and rural to urban. There are two kinds of urbanization is happening in our country. One is improving of the facilities in the rural areas and the nearby rural, that means actually say they are not big cities or towns, tier mm-hmm. 2, tier 3 towns kind of a thing, which actually developed as urban areas over a period of time. For example, if you take Vizag, Vizag is actually not a Vizag, and Gajuwaka is also became a city and included into the Vizag, that kind of a thing. So earlier, Gajuwaka used to be a small town, but when we are actually linking it, 90% of the people are living here, 46% people are living in urban, and 52% in rural, what we are actually calculating. Some are actually, it is not a migration, but cities are developed from small migration from the within the smaller cities or smaller villages to the nearby bigger village, and that bigger village actually became a municipality, and it now we are calling it as urbanization.
Yeah.
And that, how best we can stop that kind of a migration? Are we only facilities improving in the rural areas is sufficient, or along with the facilities, there are livelihoods to be put more focus to stop this kind of a migration from the rural areas? Especially if you see there are thousands of people are going by walk to 500, 600 kilometers, or where actually we work, it is around 200 kilometers from Hyderabad. But 90% of the chaat mandis, the gupchup wala mandis, are from that area in Hyderabad. So that kind of a migration, how best we can stop that migration? If we stop that migration, can we provide alternate livelihood there, or create same kind of a income opportunities if we stop that kind of a migration? That is, migration is good or not?
So here is one thing, boss. Okay, I'll quickly one line on migration, then I'll go to your question on the legality of the board, then I'll come back to this whole idea of urbanization.
Yeah, there are two things.
Migration is so first of all, the whole idea of is it good or bad is not a Indian concept. Okay, now this might sound a little weird. The idea of virtue and sin, good and evil, this and that are all Abrahamic concepts that are alien to India. Right. If you look at the whole, so it might be a facetious answer, but it's serious. Where my submission is, anything that people are permitted to do is neither good nor bad. It is just a choice.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's about it. Now we have to think of it. What does it mean in terms of, what does it mean in terms of, from a nation's point of view or from an economy's point of view? Right, so nobody should ask people to migrate. Nobody should stop people from migrating. So that's one. But let me just go back quickly to your first question. Then I'll expand on the urbanization part. The legality of setting up a new board today is absolutely legal. It has happened multiple times in India since 1947. Like I said, there are 52 education boards today, many of whom we might not even know. Right? It is just an abject lack of strategic thought and ambition on our side that we have not thought about setting up our own board. Right? I can be polite, but I don't want to be polite. People that have considered themselves leader of our thought, people that have considered themselves leaders of our thought and strategic thinkers and intellectuals are more than happy going to a conference, staying in a 5-star hotel, talking, eating and coming. When it comes to action, I'm sorry to say there is zero action whatsoever.
Yeah,
yes,
actually, we have actually tried to do that when we are setting up our chain of schools. We wanted to have our own syllabus. And for the sake of recognition and all that, we have to specify whether to state board or CBSE, that kind of a thing, that actually hinders. So if you set up a board.
The problem you are mentioning is very different. That if you are setting up, if you're looking at it at a school level, then obviously you have to align yourself with some approved board, AICT, NCERT.
So there might be lot many people those are actually facing this kind of a problem. They want to change the syllabus or change the way of their teaching, but due to lack of
ambition, lack of ambition, board. That is the word.
Lack of board, ambition.
No, boss, do not. That is, I will not take the excuse. If you do not have a board that meets your values, see, here's my thing, right? You can either complain if you can solve it, or you have no right to complain. I cannot say I don't like driving on this road because it's not pink color, it is black color. Either you build a pink road for yourself or you quietly drive on the black road. Right. I do understand the problem you are saying, and I'm being more rude than I would like to be. But I think this is a huge example. You see, I see thousands of people complaining about our education system. Okay, Macaulay did this and Romila Thapar did this and Irfan Habib did that. Okay, fine. They did what they were good at doing. They won that battle. You lost it. Stop complaining now. You see, we need to start looking at these as, you know, we need to start looking at the ideological battle that is actually is today. That ideological battle is not won by complaining or claiming victimhood or going on Twitter and going on Facebook or doing a protest. It is won by building our institutions. If you do not have, when I say you, I mean all of us collectively. If we do not have the ambition or the ability to build our own institutions, we should accept being subject to a suboptimal institution. We should expect the syllabus our children are taught. We should accept the social outcome of them learning what we abhor or whatever it is. That's it. Right. So anyway, I got a little worked up, Rajesh Garu. This is obviously nothing personally.
Actually,
this is a subject which I personally feel very strongly about.
Yeah, we have to think more on creating a proper board or bring the all 49, whatever the boards are there. And just one or create a new one. That's what actually.
You see, I'll give you a simple example. Sorry, I'm interrupting you again. Like I was saying, there are 14.5 lakh schools. The single largest board today, 16,000 schools, is CBSE. Second largest, ICSE, 1,800 schools. ICSE run by the Anglo-Indian whatever society today. Blah, blah, blah. Now, if we were to set up our own board, what do we need to be successful? Right? Today, there are 66,000 schools across India that are run by sansthas, trusts, companies, NGOs that are fundamentally aligned to our way of thinking. What do I say, our way of thinking? Our way of thinking means people that are nationalist or people that are dharmic, people that believe in Indic values, so and so, right? A bunch of Shankaracharyas run their school. There are Ekal Vidyalayas. There are Saraswati Shishu Mandir, Bal Bhavan.
Yes, yes. That's what. There are many.
66,000 of these. Mm. The simplest, most conservative target to have is over the next 10 years, we will convert 10% of these schools. That's all. Not much. I'm not even saying 10% of 14.5 lakh. I'm saying 10% of these
66,000.
That brings us to 6,600 schools. Suddenly, you are three times bigger than ICSE. You are one third the size of CBSE. Imagine how much that changes for the next generation.
Yep.
Right. The problem in on our side is, A, we will not try and understand the problem. If we understand the problem, we will try and overanalyze the problem. If we overanalyze the problem, we will try and give gyan to others, but we will not spend our energies fixing it. Therein lies all our collective failure on any issue that you think about. And yes. I'm very blunt about this. We are all talkers.
One of the biggest suggestion or a way out, because everybody wants to change the syllabus. Why should we ask to change the syllabus? Why don't we create our own board and create our own syllabus?
And also, why should somebody listen to you?
Yeah.
To you or me or anybody?
Yes. That's what.
Right. Somebody.
When we have alternate, we should go it and prove it up or prove ourselves.
You see, asking the board to change the syllabus is like going to Haldiram and saying, don't sell us bhujia, sell us muruku. Haldiram will say, hey, boss, I'll sell whatever I want to you. Want to buy, you buy. Don't want to buy, don't buy. Now, that's a problem, right? We can keep complaining, we can keep whining, you know, Twitter followers will increase and people will get to talk about it in constitutions and, conferences and people will clap and all that stuff happens, but no real sustainable change happens.
Instead of Haldiram, we have to create Mirchi Ram now. That's all this is.
Exactly.
Giri Ram.
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
as my son says, Papa, it is not Haldi Ram, it is unhealthy Ram. You should stop eating it.
Yeah. Okay.
But, just another quick response on Rajesh Garu's question on the reverse urbanization. I am acutely hopeful that we can have economic power go back to villages if there are four things that are built, right? One is, and again, they're in different stages of building across different parts of the country. If you have good physical infrastructure, roads as an example, right? If you have good infrastructure of utilities, like electricity has started reaching villages, water has started reaching villages, right? These things from a sustenance point of view is kind of important. Third is if you have a decent financial infrastructure, banks, payment facilities, etc. And I have huge faith in digital payments today. And fourth, most importantly, given that most new age production, depends on technology to a huge extent, is if you have huge bandwidth or pipelines made for data, right? If these four criteria are met, and we should not say that, you know, all our villages should grow at the same time, there should be one massive spending. No, let us go about it in a phased manner.
Yeah.
Right. By the way, I'm not even talking about the administrative definition failure and whatever. Every time you bring in one Sarkari Babu, they will snatch defeat from the jaws of victory. Right. So I'm not even talking about that. I'm purely talking about the resurgence of villages. The minute you provide both hard and soft infrastructure, naturally you will have growth going into those villages.
Yeah, but I think there is also need to invest in skill development and technology there.
I don't think so, boss.
No, it is not.
I'll tell you what has happened, because I actually live in a village. So the problem there is the education system which they go through right now doesn't give them the skill sets or the tools to really be able to do some things on their own or to really handle this. So what are they forced to? They are forced to go to a city to earn a livelihood. Or they are in agri or agro-based related stuff.
Sir, we all understand the problem, Giridhar Garu. We are talking about the solution here.
So what is the IT kind of a concept which gives some kind of a support to them in terms of doing something on their own, the kind of an empowerment if they are able to do that.
For a migration, there are two kinds of people. Those who are actually migrates more. One is they say that for the better education of my children is one, or health facilities is two. These two, they say that, not the income or better opportunities, other things. But these two things majorly, actually, most of the people are taking excuse for leaving their village. We don't have proper school, so we are going to nearby area. We don't have education.
You have to trust India's, an average Indian's ability to jugaad, to create solutions, to create opportunities where none exist. You see, you have to trust that. I personally consider it, the reason the National Skills Development Council is, in my view, a huge failure is because they have focused on the supply side and not on the demand side. Right. It is, again, a very command and control mentality that we have to do something for them. The minute you say us and them, you're not dharmic. There is no us, there is no them. It is all us. It is all me. I am you and you are me. Now, the whole reason NSDC frameworks have failed is because they have said, oh, let us set up a school for plumbing. Let us set up an ITI here, ITI there, blah, blah, blah. They have created an army of people that they are calling skilled. I am just, I say they are certified. They may or may not be skilled, right? Whichever company hires them has to retrain them. You tell me one company that has hired a certified professional and not felt the need for training them again.
Right.
You see, you should leave it to enterprise to manage their way out. A government's job or a nation's job is to just create the infrastructure to enable them to do what they need to. Baki, the ecosystem, you see, there was an abject failure in the age of technology in our institute, in our education institutions. You had NIIT and APTEC that came up and started providing a solution that either corporates or government was not willing to provide. You should trust the ability of solution providers, of businessmen, of enterprises, of entrepreneurs to create that solution the minute a need arises for it. You don't have to worry about you don't have to worry about that aspect. You have to worry about just enabling them.
Hanumanluji, please go ahead.
Hello. Sir, I think we have to highlight the successful models of by Palan ancient Indian models of economy, or we can say Dharmicism, or cooperative system, or social model, that will help to others also to motivate and encourage them to transform towards Indianization of all entities, maybe commercial education institutions. I think that will help to link to highlight the success of those organizations.
You're absolutely right, sir. And in fact, which is why I was giving examples of the local version of CSR, you know, dharmshalas, temples, kitchens, this, that, whatever. Which is why I was giving examples of how we maintain, traditional businessmen maintain bahi khatas and this. You see, I think there are lots of examples if we just look around, right? My hope is that with time, each of us will start finding those examples and sharing it. You know, the biggest failure of an idea is that an individual feels it, not a community or not a group or not a society. So you're absolutely right. I think in the article, in fact, somebody just posted it on the right side here, you know, on the messages. I've given a few examples there, but again, you don't need me for examples to talk about Dharmicism. It is there, in and around your life every day, right? A gummadikaya that they put outside a shop, right? Is an example of introducing a higher power than yourself into your business. It provides, employment to a farmer, a bullock cart owner who brings it to the city, to the artist who paints it, etc., etc. There are huge examples. You know, just take a simple example of the amount of trust on which Indian businesses work with. Right, the fact that I can give you a loan, that we don't have to put it on a stamp paper, this and that, and that there are community controls to ensure that you will give that loan back to me. Right, you see, nobody has accounted for interpersonal or inter-entity trust that Indians naturally have when we measure when we make any kind of calculation or measure. So these examples are all around us, sir.
Ravi ji, go ahead. Yeah, Dheeraj, you are unmuted. Raviji, you can talk. I think there's something with him. Okay, then we'll go to Amarchand ji. Amarchand, please go ahead.
Everyone. My question is, after P.V. Narasimha Rao's game changer policy, like liberalization and globalization, due to liberalization, many small people also started their companies and they were progressing well. But at the same time, due to the globalization, the idea of globalization is good. The local companies also will get a quality competency along with the global players. So what is happening that our companies also improved a lot and competing more than global companies? For example, Thumbs Up, Limca, Gold Spot. You take any Parle products, even the Hotmail, the email founder Hotmail, you take Flipkart, Voila, whatever, recently Paytm. So there are a number of companies are there. But when our potential is so high, but the global players' economy power is so high that they are taking over our local companies and they are controlling our companies. So how to stop this? Does government has any plans for this? My simple thought process is any company which is having a turnover more than 100 crores should be listed public. So that what happens, many small middle-class people and many other investors will start investing there and it becomes a big fish. So it is tough to acquire a bigger companies by the global players. So now Tata company is so big and no one will dare to acquire that company. Rather, Tata is acquiring foreign companies now in the foreign land. So and listing the companies when we mandate, two things can happen. Even a small middle class people from their saving, they cannot buy a land or gold or something, but they can invest in new companies. So this is my idea. So do you have any better plans, or government has any done some brainstorming?
So there are a couple of things. So A, I don't speak for the government. That's a question you should ask them. If anything, I disagree with them more than I agree with them. So a couple of things, sir. First of all, just from a constitutional legality point of view, you cannot mandate a company to change its form or this. If people want to run a 10,000 crore company as a partnership, they have the constitutional right to do so. So that is tough to change. Now, having said that, there are quite a few companies in India that have displayed global ambition, right? What you might consider, and which is true, what you might consider a competitive weakness, which is, Indian companies are so small, Western companies are so big, is also seen as a competitive advantage by many when they say, Kare, if it's a small company, I'm more nimble. I can act quicker. My cost of operation is low. I can take bigger risks, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the argument is both ways. You see, there are large companies in India and let's say the USA. There are small companies in the USA also. There are small companies in India also. Large Indian companies have bought small foreign companies. Large foreign companies have bought small Indian companies. So I don't think you can apply the idea of dharmicism, especially because India has chosen to be a democracy that guarantees certain constitutional rights. So you can't extend the concept of dharmicism. What you can look at is to say, well, dharmicism is a fair and balanced enabler, that in the long term, the sustainability concepts that are intrinsic to dharmicism will ensure that players in the economy succeed. And therefore, collectively, Indian enterprises or the Indian economy starts playing a bigger role in the world. Rather than saying, dharmicism is a tool to enable one industry or one player to grow large enough to acquire a foreign company. That is, I would not look at that as the objective of introducing dharmicism.
Sure. I think we have crossed the 2-hour deadline. I think we'll try and wind up. I think Sandeep Ji had another question. I think we'll let him ask his second question and then we'll go into the wind-up mode. Yeah, Sandeep Ji, go ahead. Yeah.
Thank you for the second turn. The question is, I have sent an article which is from Forbes, which says New Zealand has ditched GDP model and has switched to happiness index as way of accounting the well-being of their citizens. Is there anything that we can take as a lesson from them? How do we start from there?
Yeah, look, there are multiple non-financial, and I think that's a very interesting thread to catch on, right? What is the ultimate objective of human endeavor, right? If society can find a way of, I'm just using a random example, right? Let's say there are two societies. This society has a per capita income of $50,000. This one has $20,000. but they have found ways for these people to be more happy than these people. Then which model is better? Without getting into an opinion on which model is better, because you know with every person the opinion will be different. I think the interesting takeaway for me from you know from an happiness index is that people are thinking in terms of alternate yardsticks. जिसको हिंदी में मापदंड बोलते हैं, right? You know, in the history of the world as we know it, in recent say last 200, 300, 400 years, nobody has thought of a measurement index beyond dollars and cents or rupees and paisa. The fact that a happiness index exists means that there is an opportunity to introduce more indices. That's the direction in which we should be thinking, right? If you look for example, at the impact investment industry, they have non-financial indices. So they say 3 P's, people, planets, and profits, right? So they measure impact on those terms. There are surrogate measures, there are complex hybrid measures that a lot of industries have come up with. And eventually, I think these kind of models will have to evolve. And honestly, there is no one answer, right? I mean, on one end, you could say that happiness index is a strong index, which I believe it is a strong index. Somebody else could say, boss, I don't want, like China is saying, right? I don't want my people to be happy. I just want them to be prosperous. And right now, I don't even want my people to be prosperous. I want my country to be prosperous. Right, so happiness be damned. Let me focus on something else.
Yeah, okay, sure.
No easy answer there.
Yeah, next is Ravi. Ravi ji, please answer.
Namaste.
Now okay, yeah.
Namaste, sir.
Namaste, sir.
మన ధార్మికిజంని ఇతర ధార్మిక్ వరల్డ్స్ ఎట్లా ఒప్పుకుంటాయి, ఎలా మనల్ని అసలు గ్రో అవనిస్తాయి? ఇతర ధర్మాలు మనల్ని ఎట్లా బతకనిస్తాయి? మనం ధార్మికిజం అంటాము కానీ వాళ్ళు మనల్ని బతకనివ్వాలి కదా, మనల్ని గ్రో అవనివ్వాలి కదా.
గురుగారు మీరు అలౌ చేస్తే నేను ఇంగ్లీష్ లో ఆన్సర్ ఇవ్వనా?
ఇంగ్లీష్ లోనే ఇవ్వండి సార్, నేను తెలుగులో ఈజీగా అర్థం అవడానికి
చెప్తాను. అదే పర్లేదు, కానీ అంటే మా తెలుగు చాలా వీక్ సార్, సో అందుకే. ఇప్పుడు నౌ ద థింగ్ ఇస్ అగైన్ ఇట్స్ అ వెరీ గుడ్ క్వశ్చన్, కి ఇన్ అ వార్ ఆఫ్ నేరేటివ్స్ వై షుడ్ సమ్ అదర్ కల్చర్ అలౌ అవర్ కల్చర్ ఆర్ అవర్ మోడల్, వై విల్ దే అక్సెప్ట్ ఇట్? Right. There are two questions. Why will they accept it domestically within India? Why will others outside India accept it? So there are two levels of questions. Now, there are a couple of different ways to solve this, Ravi Babu. One is, might is right. If you see, why are people accepting the Chinese model today? Right? COVID virus is only a new export. Before this, there was SARS. There was, you know, 101 different illnesses that have come out of China. You know, hundreds of years back, there was the Black Plague, which came out of China, entered through Italy, surprisingly, and then spread to all of Europe. 25 million people had died. Right? Why is a Chinese economic model today accepted by the rest of the world? Because they have the economic might to do so. Once India has the economic might, our model automatically gets accepted. That is one. Second is, even if you don't think of it from a push point of view, from a pull point of view, a lot of components of Dharmikism are already being accepted today. Right? When you say, when a new age company says that we want to follow benevolent HR practices, that recognizes individuals to be whoever they are. Take a simple example. 30 years back, how many companies used to have a dress code or uniform versus today? Not having a dress code or a uniform is a recognition of the fact that you as an individual are unique with a unique set of choices and tastes, and we will give you the freedom to be who you are. That is a form of dharmikism, right? When companies go out and say, you see, you just look at vision statement and mission statements and goals of companies. 30 years back, they used to have very unidimensional goals. Right. Today, the stated goals of companies include environment, include employees, include stakeholders, include community. Right. The same company, you look at their goal statement or vision statement from 30 years back, and 1980 ka or 1990 ka, you compare it to today. Companies are evolving into automatically accepting the ideas of Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Right? Those ideas are being accepted anyways. We just have to articulate it and present it in a holistic manner and say, okay, boss, why are you taking one or two ideas here and there? Here is an overall proposal from India's side. Accept it. So like I said, there is a little bit of push. There will be a, which will be India as a emerging economy will have the ability to push, like we already have the ability to push people diplomatically. Right? They're following our diplomatic models. We will develop the natural ability to push our economic model. Now, whether we choose to use that might or not is a different story. That's where our bureaucrats have failed. We don't recognize our own strength. That's a different story. But A, we'll have, you know, strength will give us the ability to push it. B, the way companies are evolving, the, you know, you see, dharmic models are naturally more woke models, right? They're more acceptable to the hip, cool, educated, urban Western audience. Exactly the way yoga is and turmeric latte is. So I'm fairly hopeful that there is a natural evolution, and despite anybody else that wants to bring us down, see, counter forces will always be there. You know, I run India Pride Project. There are more people that want me not to bring back murtis or heritage than there are people who want me to bring back murtis or heritage, right? You talk to 20 different people within our own side. Five of them will tell you Anurag is an evil guy. They will give you some gossip, some slander, some misinformation. So the point I'm saying is you don't need the other side to try and pull down our idea. Our side itself will do it before that, right? We just need to make sure that our value proposition is strong enough that it gets naturally absorbed and pushed by our emerging strength.
Okay, great. I think we'll take the last question and then we'll go into wind up.
After Akshay, the last questions, I need 2 minutes to wind up, sir.
Sure. And before you get your 2 minutes, I will ask you something else.
Sure.
So, we'll just, Akshay ji, please go ahead. Yeah. Dheeraj, you're unmuted. Yeah. Akshay ji, please go ahead. Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah.
Yeah, I want your perspective on universal basic income from dharmic perspective. And the other question was, what will be the global currency after dollar? Because it's not going to last long, as we can see. So that are my questions. And thank you.
Thank you, Akshay ji. The second question actually is a very interesting question. I honestly do not have an answer to that. The best of the economists don't. So I will not say how long dollar might last as as a standard currency. So unfortunately, I'll have to decline answering that. Universal basic income is more interesting. So I'm in a lot of forums where UBI is discussed on a fairly serious note. There are two mega trends that will allow for it. There will be... See, automated farming has started to a very large extent. Automated manufacturing is getting to a stage where most jobs are getting redundant. You see, I was hearing about in Singapore, there is a McDonald's that where you cannot place your order to a human being. There's just a touch screen or you can place it from your own phone. So in Singapore, they've taken away the human beings from the ordering part of things. In Tokyo, they've taken away human beings from the kitchen part of things. The burger gets automatically made. Now you put both these models together and you'll have a McDonald's where nobody's flipping a burger. And all of that is reality. We will take time before, from a logistical perspective, we get to that stage as a reality. At that point of time, it might start with the Nordic countries first. Of course, post-COVID, nobody knows what will happen. But countries with a fair amount of prosperity might take the first stab at universal basic income. Regardless of when it happens, where it starts, the interesting part is there are, so what are the Nordic countries discussing today? That a lot of private responsibilities will be nationalized. It is not your job to earn anymore. Somebody will feed you. It is not your job to stay healthy anymore. We'll take care of you if you see a bad day. I mean, not that it's not your job. It is that if you do not have food, if you are not in good health, if you're not able to educate yourself, the government will take care of all these things, which is no different from the whole idea of Rajdharma, right? Ki, what are the traits that a Raja is supposed to display? Again, Shanti Parva that I mentioned earlier, Arthashastra and a whole bunch of texts maintains the right of not just citizens, as in not just human beings, but the rights that plants, animals, rivers, etc., etc., have, because we consider divinity in everything. So I think when UBI gets to a more evolved level of becoming universal in the true sense, not just universal to humans, that is the time where it will start looking very similar to the concepts that are there in our dharmic texts. Unfortunately, they have not yet evolved to a level where they start thinking in terms of, you know, that the bird has a right, a tree has a right, a river has a right. We traditionally believe that it has a right, but I think an evolved form of UBI would be very similar to the idea of dharmicism, or the idea of a king's or a kingdom or a government's duty towards its people. I don't know, Akshayji, if that answers your question.
Yeah. I think we'll close it at that. Last but not the least, I thought some of my CA friends would raise it, and none of them did. I thought now ultimately it falls upon me. I will raise it now. I think the institute itself, our institute itself, is seeped in colonial policies and what have you. Our accounting standards, especially those that came out later, are nothing but carbon copies of what the US GAAP or other GAAPs are there. You know, it is nothing indigenous to it. Like what you said, most of our accounting has become compliance oriented rather than really of any of use to the businessman. He follows his own way of accounting. His traditional way of accounting. He doesn't care for your accounting standards. We have an accounting standards, whereas the company law nor the income tax recognizes that. They have their own set of rules where you have to follow. So we are in quite a big mess. I think the institute will have to rise to the occasion. For instance, China doesn't care for any of your gaps. It's a superpower. You go to Gulf, they don't care for any of your gaps. They do their own stuff. Yet, huge amount of FDI flows in there. The big four have been selling to this country that unless you follow US GAAP or you follow all these structured the way of presenting your accounts, you're not going to get funds from abroad. So that has gone deep into all the corporate world in India. I think it's important that the institute really produces policies and standards and concepts which are rooted in Indianness, in Bharatiya dharmic way of looking at it, and the way our Indian businesses are running their show. I think that is badly needed now. We need to produce something very unique to Bharat rather than live with this borrowed or carbon copied concepts. I've been espousing this among our friends, but the problem is we are all products of the same education system. So we only think in terms of ATC should increase to 2 lakh rupees, instead of 1 lakh, and you add something else for something else. We are only nitpicking here and there. We are not able to look at it from a dharmic point of view. That's an area where I think we need to really overhaul and give an alternate model to the institute itself. Unfortunately, institute is losing that leadership role as we see it right now. These are my thoughts. Maybe you would want to add to it, or you want to react to it, and then you can
come. So again, I'll my answer might not make our fellow members of ICAI too happy, but I'll still say it anyways. You see, there's a lot of international treaties, protocols, agreements, you know, the Kyoto Protocol, SOX, GAP, this, that. We have to adhere to it because that is a part of our geopolitical responsibility to adhere to them. Right? If you're a member of this UN, you know, this multilateral, that committee, blah, 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 you have no option but to sign up. So therefore we align to those norms. And it is correct that a country needs to project a certain legal and process infrastructure if it needs to attract the kind of FDI and FII that India has needed, even in our last couple of decades. It would be vain to say that India doesn't need money from anybody else. If you need money from, if you need money to flow in, you have to give them the comfort that it is familiar, safe territory. Having said that, the need for evolution you talk about will, I honestly, personally don't think it would be either led or triggered or managed by institutions like ICAI. Institutions, and it could be the company secretaries, ICWA, whatever it is, right? These are essentially professional bodies that take a set of laws and ensure their implementation. They should normally not be tasked with making either policies or laws or the direction that a nation needs to take. That job needs to exist outside with someone else or with groups of people outside. Regulatory bodies or professional bodies, I believe, have a relatively limited role to play. You know, once the rules of the game are laid out, once the norms are there, once our geopolitical position is strong enough to enforce it, they can be the people who ensure adherence. Usse zyada, it's not their job to do so, sir. I mean, that's just my limited view. Exactly like it is not a doctor's job to develop a new drug.
See, where I'm coming from is China receives maybe 5 or 6 times more FDI than India receives, right? And Gulf receives very close to what India receives. I mean, I'm saying Gulf as a whole put together. They don't follow any of these norms, right? I've been there. I've worked there in the Gulf. I've seen what it is, and I've seen the Chinese accounting standards. So sure. the investors who come there, they put their own people to try and convert it into their gaps to understand it, but China doesn't care for it. But the might of China, the opportunity in China, the business opportunity in China is driving these guys to go and invest there. It is not the standards which suit them. It's not the same standards. Same thing with the Gulf. You know, it's what the sponsor decides will be the rules of the game. Depreciation. He says, I'm going to stop the depreciation for 3 years. You can't do anything about it. Your NPA rules don't fly there because government of Dubai itself has defaulted for 2 years. How can you put a government in an NPA, government debt in an NPA? So I've seen this. What has happened is whether you follow the internationally accepted, recognized standards or not, FDI still flows into these countries. So what I figured out is if you are confident, proud, and if you are independent, people will respect you. They don't respect you because you are following standards set by them or the standards which they are following. This is what I've recognized. Someday down the road, whether institute or somebody else, we have to come up with our own set of rules rooted in our own dharmic way of looking at things. And the world will recognize that strength. The moment we have strength, the moment they see that India has opportunity and they cannot live without being part of India story, they will accept your accounts. They will accept your policies. We don't have to bow down to them. This is my view.
Absolutely, sir. I mean, exactly what I meant when I said that might is right.
Yeah. Sure. I think you wanted to say something in conclusion and then we will conclude it. Yeah.
Okay. So, we're done with the questions, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let me just make some quick parting comments. I mean, first of all, thank you so much, Giridhar ji. These are the kind of conversations and you know, stirring of the mind that keeps us sane, you know, being locked at home. In fact, all of you have been locked a little longer than we have been locked. So I think you should, so first of all, my congrats, you should keep doing this on a regular basis. Second, I just have a little bit of a homework or request or whatever you call it. And, you know, I think I also said it in response, kind of alluded to it a little earlier. You see, the problem that I see with our side is that while there is a lot of intent that we all have, there is very limited focus on action. Right? And when you compare it to the other side, you know, I always tell people, you know, the other side has one Chanakya and 99 Yodhas or Jihadis or this or that or whatever you want to call a fighter. Right? So there's one thinker, 99 doers. Our side, there are 99 Chanakyas and one Yodha.
Yeah.
These 99 Chanakya won't let the Yodha fight. He'll say, boss, you come, you sit on my lotus feet, I will give you Gyan.
Yeah. Right?
So my request as a general principle, and I will bring it down to the whole Dharmakism thing as well, is that now that we understand the idea of Dharmakism a little bit or anything else that you might care for, let us go beyond these discussion, katha, kalakshepam, whatever you want to call it. My specific request to all of you is, somebody had shared the link on this chat, but this chat will go away. So Giridharji or Raghuji will share the link with you later. But read about the whole idea of Dharmakism. It's a simple thought. It doesn't take more than 10-15 minutes. After that, you choose whether you agree or disagree. And frankly, I don't care. You have the right to disagree with me, right? But if you agree, you push it forward. That's my only request from you. And when I say push it forward, I mean genuinely push it forward. I don't mean that you should plan or advise or think and this and that. No. Actively push the idea forward, because otherwise we will keep losing battles. Like we talked about the whole education example, where we have lost the battle for 70 years. Our children are still learning concepts that are not just archaic, but dangerous. We have lost that battle. I don't want us to lose this battle, right? Find, if you do agree with this idea of Dharmakism, find ways to push it, right? In whichever way you can. Each of you send an email to 50 people and say, hey, you know, I was just sitting on a Zoom call today. I learned these 50, you know, these five things. Great idea. Send that email to 50 people. Send the link if you want to send your thoughts, right? If this compels you enough, then write about it. Write an article, have it published somewhere. I don't care if it is in Hindi, Hindi, Telugu, English, Kannada, whatever it is, right? You know, next time after this COVID thing is sorted, talk to it in groups of people. Have debates around it. Think about collectively how, think of it like Amway if you need to. You know that 50 of us will talk to 50 each, will talk to 50 each, will talk to 50 each, right? Finally, think in terms of how you can start making it a reality rather than a concept or a discussion point or whatever else it is. Once that happens is when these two and a half hours of our life would have been spent usefully. Otherwise, we have just all collectively wasted a lot of time unproductively with nothing coming out of it, while the other side is sharpening its swords.
Yeah, in fact, we are planning what we are calling as study groups. We want to create groups where we pick up each of these concepts and then on the similar lines what you suggested, you want to bring an alternate
model. Saying the opposite. I'm saying the opposite, Giridharji. I'm saying let us move away from theory. So I'm saying exactly the opposite of study groups. Study is about enriching yourself. I'm saying think of it outward, not inward.
Yeah, the point is, unless you are aware of the concepts, you are not going to go tell others, right?
No, the point is,
we are so colonized, we don't even know these concepts. So the point is, we want to have these groups where we invest time to first have some kind of understanding of this. Then each of a study group is going to be a small group. They will be tasked to go out and do this. Some of them may give lectures in the institutes or in the colleges or wherever it is. Some of them, like what you said, may be publishing letters. Some of them may be writing books, complete books itself. Or maybe we do some video clips. But for that, we need this cohesive group, which is going to really work on how we're going to produce this. That's the way we are looking at it.
Oh, absolutely. Get it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, fantastic. I think we'll conclude it with that. I think we have done more than 7.5 hours. Sorry, 2.5 hours, it looks like, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Anurag ji, for your time and your
pleasure, boss. Thoughts. My absolute pleasure.
Yeah, and it was a, you know, I know these concepts are very a little abstract for people to really, you know, see through this. Unless they see some examples, it's very tough for people, we understand. But, you know, this is an emerging thought process, and I'm sure people would catch up with that as time goes by. And like what you said rightly, these conversations should happen. That's how intellectual churning should really replace the old archaic order in due course. And thanks to everybody, whoever is on the call so late even now. And Lakshminarayan Garu, special thanks to you. You know, you've been an inspiration to us every day. You're here for such a long time, and that gives us a lot of, you know, sense of responsibility to take this much further. Thank you all so much. And let me remind you, tomorrow we are going to have R. Vaidyanathan ji in the evening. Same time, 5 o'clock. Anurag ji, thanks a lot again.
Acha, boss, Prof. Vaidya is coming tomorrow, is it?
Yes, he's coming tomorrow.
Oh, good, good. Please tell him that you had a talk today with one of his biggest fans.
Yeah. And yeah, if you have time, hop on.
Inspiration comes from here. Yeah, please send me the link. I would love to.
Yeah, I will do that. You can hop on. Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Thanks, everybody. Namaskar.
Thanks a lot. Bharat Mata Ki Jai. Namaste.
Aapko bhi.